let's talk some more about compact operators. So, what were the compact operators? Something about the unit ball? Yeah, what about the unit ball?
Like, it gets mapped into something compact?
Yeah. So T of, I don't know how we want to write unit ball. It's just about unit ball. It's compact. And the fantastic theorem that we proved, which had epsilons and deltas flying all over the place, was that the compact operators are the norm closure of the finite rank operators. So finite rank, of course, just meant that the range of the operator is just a finite rank of a vector space. And we proved the theorem in two parts. So first of all, we said that, I can't remember what order we said it in anymore, but first of all, every compact operator is a limit of finite rank operators. So you've got these guys, Tn, Tn minus T, the norm of that is converted to this zero, and these are all finite rank. And moreover, not only is every compact operator a norm limit of finite rank operators, the set of compact operators is closed in the norm topology. Okay, so you've got a sequence of compact operators converging in norm to something, that thing is itself compact. And those two facts together can be expressed that way, saying it's the compact, that they're the norm closure of the finite rank operators. And so that's nice. We want to prove today a few things. One of them is a beautiful fact. It's really an algebraic fact about the compact operators. So the compact operators form an ideal of H, a two-sided ideal, but if you don't know what a two-sided ideal is, I'm just going to say it exactly. So if S is compact, T is bounded, and ST and TS are compact. Okay, so when you've got a product of a bunch of operators, and any one of them in the list is compact, the whole product is compact. Okay, so that's That's a lovely property of the compact operators. Let's prove that. So how does this go? Well, it's pretty simple. Let's do ST first. So if Fn is a bounded sequence, remember, we're assuming that T here is a bounded operator. And TFn is a bounded sequence too. Okay. These are bounded by some M. This is bounded by norm of T times M. Okay. So we can just treat that TFn as our sequence that we're thinking about sequential compactness for. When we apply S to that, this has a convergent subsequence. Okay, maybe remember this alternative statement here. It's T is compact if and only if for every bounded sequence, Fn, T applied to Fn as a convergent subsequence. This is just using the idea that compactness just means sequential compactness when you're in a metric space. The event is a metric space. Okay? So we just showed that for some arbitrary sequence Fn, St applied to Fn has a convergent subsequence. So St is bounded. St is compact. And then in the other direction, we need to look at T then S. Okay? So we can say that SFn has a convergent subsequence see we've got S, F, N subscript K is converging to some G. Okay. But then since T is continuous, so notice, well, so let's just do it. So since T is continuous, you can just say T, S, F, N, K converges to T. Okay. So here we found some subsequence of the original sequence Fn, so that Ts applied to it was convergent. So Ts is common. It's kind of cute here in the two different halves of the proof. We used the two different equivalent versions of saying that T is bounded. Here we're really using the T is bounded to go from this sequence being bounded going to this sequence is bounded. Whereas here we're using the T is continuous, okay? So that you can use convergence here to deduce convergence there. And that's the proof of the fact that the compact operators form ideal. And one more baby fact. T is compact if and only if T star is compact. This one's kind of cute. We can do it very cheaply with all this machinery about the compact operators being the norm closure of finite Wrangle. So, is there a subtlety here that I'm missing? Yeah, okay. So, let's see. I'm a bit worried something's about to go wrong. So let's see. So we'll take our T. So suppose T is compact. So approximate T by finite rank operators. So Tn is converging norm to T. Okay. And so then Tn star converges in norm to T star. Okay, this is just using the fact the norm of the adjoint of something is equal to the norm of the something. Okay, and you can just get that directly from the definition of the supremum, the definition of the norm. Well, sorry, it's not the definition, the formula for the norm, where we take the supremum over F and G, both of norm 1. You can see that you can move the A over and then flip the inner product over using the Sescu linearity of the inner product, or sorry, the symmetry of the inner product, and get this. Okay, so what's this good for? What's the last step of the argument meant to be? Show Tn star is also finite rank, and T star is a norm limit of finite rank operators, and so compact. So we're really using sort of both halves of that theorem from Monday. We're first of all approximating T by finite rank guys, and then we're saying, oh, then a limit of finite rank guys is compact again. But this fact here is maybe not particularly obvious. If you've got some finite rank operator, why is its adjoint also finite rank? So I think from memory, but there's actually a problem. So, looking at it, the notes should give a little bit more explanation of that point. But from what I remember, the problem set, the last problem on the problem set, proves something about finite rank operators that makes this very easy to see. So maybe let's just defer that for now, and we'll come back to that question when we finish going through the problem set next Monday, and we'll remember to use part problem seven on the problem set to see this little consequence. Yeah, I mean, the way you prove this is by doing that problem, so I sort of don't want to spoil it. Okay, so there's a step there that we'll defer till a little bit later, but you can hopefully see how the big theorem is being used. Adil, you look a little bit unhappy. Are you unhappy about this? Or you just can't see it? Okay. So that's that. Let's give an example at this point. Let's give a nice example. So I want to give an example now of some nice compact operators that are not at all obviously compact until you've seen this result about the compact operators being norm limits of finite rank operators. So this is these are integral operators. So let's see. To say k. Some L2 function on E cross E, where E is, well, given we've only done analysis 2 so far, we'll just say measurable set in Rn, and this will work fine for just an abstract measure space a little bit later in the course. And then we'd say the integral operator T with kernel K is the function, is the operator, so maybe I should have said it's the operator from L2 of E to L2 of E that takes a function and now it can just spit out a new function. And so I'm going to tell you what that function is by telling you its value at points. And so this is the integral over E of kxy fy dy. Okay, so this is the notion of an integral operator with a specified kernel. And the you can try and define this operator without assuming that k is L2. But the conclusion here, maybe I should rearrange this. So let's say, it's just for now, for that definition, we just say k is some function from e cross e to the complex numbers or the real numbers, whatever you like. But then if k is in L2 of e cross e, T is a compact operator. Okay. And the way this works is the following. Is just observe that if K is a characteristic function, it's just 0 or 1 everywhere on E cross E, then you can show that what you can see is that, in particular, so depending on the value of x here, this k of xy is either just 0 or 1, okay? And for values of x where this is 1, it's just the integral of k of y times f of y, and so in particular it can't depend on x. The only way this can depend on x is whether x is in the set or not, where k of xy is 1. So what I want to say then is that TF is finite rank. In fact, rank 1. Is that what I want to say? Oh, sorry. No. This is bogus. Sorry. We need to be a bit more precise. So if K looks like a characteristic function, it's a product of two characteristic functions. So maybe let me write that out. Okay. Now it works. So if K is a characteristic function like this, a product of a characteristic function in the two separate variables, then you can simplify this guy. Effectively, this just comes out the front. Okay? And you can see that this is just some constant now. Okay? And so we have some multiple of that characteristic function. So this is a rank 1 function. You will always just get multiples of that guy. Okay. And now, since the simple functions are dense in L2, we can approximate T by integral operators. Whose kernel is a sum of these characteristic functions and if you've got a kernel is a sum of these characteristic functions then it's finite rank but maybe not necessarily rank 1 and this tells you we can approximate T finite ranks, so T is compact. Now, there's a conspicuous part of this argument that I've left out that you guys can maybe think about. So here, I'm using denseness of the simple functions in L2, okay, to approximate my kernel. And the thing you've got to check is that if I've got two kernel functions which are very close in the L2 sense, then the corresponding integral operators for those two kernel functions are close in the B of H sense. Okay, so you've got to just do some bound. It's easy to prove, but you've got to show that if two different kernels are close in the L2 sense, then the corresponding integral operators, which are elements of B of L2 of E, bounded operators in L2 of E, then those two integral operators are close. And that's the step where, but I haven't checked explicitly here. Approximating the kernel by simple functions really means you're approximating the integral operator by the corresponding integral operators. Okay, so that's cool. That's a big class of compact operators. And in fact, quite a bit later in the course, we'll in some sense see that actually all compact operators look like that in some sense. That is, well, I'm going to write this down, but hopefully we'll get to it later. You can always produce some unitary isomorphism from your Hilbert space to L2 of E for some measure space E, so that when you sort of move back and forth by that unitary isomorphism, your arbitrary compact operator looks like one of these integral operators on the side. We'll talk about that a bit more later. Okay, so I think that gets us to the big theorem now that hopefully we can prove most of today. So a compact self-adjoint operator has an orthonormal basis consisting of eigenvectors, so we have T EI equals lambda I EI. And even better, these lambda I's converge to zero as I goes to infinity. So, I mean, another way of thinking about this is that outside any little ball around zero, there are only finitely many eigenvalues that are bigger than that ball. But you might actually have infinitely many eigenvalues. So this is a fantastic result. It basically tells you that things are almost as good as in the finite dimensional world. I mean, in the finite dimensional world, well, everything was automatically compact, but self-adjoint matrices really did have an orthonormal basis of eigenvectors. We knew that, and we're just saying we get the same setup in infinite dimensional case. So this is really nice. We've got this beautiful characterization of compact operators. They're the norm closure of the finite rank operators, and then we have this theorem that tells us sort of we get everything we could possibly want when we're looking at least the self-adjoint ones. You get this orthonormal basis of eigenvectors. Okay, so this theorem has lots of moving parts. So let's draw a big line and do a few little preparatory things before we actually try and tackle the theorem. So let's see. Let's just first have a few facts about self-adjoint operators. So distinct eigenspaces. For a self-adjoint operator, are orthogonal. Okay. So this is actually just a fact that you already knew in the finite dimensional case. When you diagonalize a symmetric matrix, your eigenvectors are orthogonal, and the proof is exactly the same because it's only really a two-dimensional thing we're thinking about. We just need to take for each pair of eigenvectors with different eigenvalues, we just need to prove they're orthogonal. There's nothing really infinite dimensional going on. So we just say TV equals lambda V, TW equals mu W, and now we just directly compute the inner product of V and W. Well, how can you do this? One way that you can do it is you could write this as lambda inverse, lambda V, W. Of course, if the proof I'm giving here is a bit lame because it assumes lambda is not zero, but you can fill in the corner cases yourself when one of the eigenvectors is zero, if you like. And then write that as lambda inverse TVW, and then lambda inverse VTW. So we use self-adjointness there to move the T across without having to put a star on it. And then pull out lambda inverse V U W, and then lambda inverse U bar V W. Okay, so what's going on here? Well, did I screw up something there? I don't think so. Okay, so these two numbers are equal. Okay. These are just an equation in the complex numbers. So either, I should have done something. Should have done a prelemma first. Either this is equal to 1, or the inner product is 0. And the prelemma that I should have done.
The eigenvalues are real.
Sorry? The eigenvalues are real, exactly, yeah. That eigenvalues self-adjoint operators. Okay. And maybe we'll leave that one for you guys as an exercise, but then this tells you the alternatives are either that lambda equals mu or the two eigenvectors are actually orthogonal. Okay, so that one's not so exciting. What else do we need? The next thing I wanted to see which actually so V is an eigenspace of some self-adjoint guy. And T preserves the orthogonal complement. Okay? So certainly preserves the eigenspace because it just acts on that eigenspace by the scalar. But we want to say that everything in the orthogonal complement stays in the stays orthogonal to all of the eigenvalues. Well, maybe let me say it is still self-adjoint. As an operator, V per. So what's this calculation here? Well, W is orthogonal to V per. What do we need to do? We just need to calculate TW, comma V for some V in that eigenspace. So of course we just use the self-adjointness of T there, but we just assume that W was orthogonal to everything in the eigenspace. Okay, so that argument's really easy, but I'll leave it to you to think exactly what that statement actually means. Okay, that when we think of it, when we restrict it to an operator from V per to V per, it's still self-adjoint. Once you've thought about what that means, it's trivial. There's sort of no calculation to do to check it, but it's worth understanding that there is a statement there. Okay. What else do we need? Moreover, if T is compact, when we take T and restrict it to V per, so if we've got this map from V per to V per, this guy is compact too. This is sort of, I mean, you can think about this many different ways, but I mean, it's very simple. I mean, you take some bounded sequence here, and of course, then you can think of that as some bounded sequence in the whole Hilbert space H, because this is just some subspace of H. And then, of course, T applied to that sequence has a convergent subsequence, okay? And that whole convergent subsequence was still sitting in here. For any sequence in V per, T applied to it has a convergent subsequence, just because it had the convergent subsequence up in H, and V per is closed, so that limit of the convergent subsequence, exciting, that limit of the convergent subsequence is still in V per. Okay? Okay, and so putting those facts together, we have the following little theorem. For T is compact and self-adjoint, we can write H as the direct sum over lambda complex number V lambda, so here I mean the lambda eigenspace. Okay. Plus some other bit where y I could have maybe left out self-adjoint to say this first bit, where y contains no eigenvectors. And actually, T maps Y to Y and is compact. There. Okay? So, what are we doing? We're just saying, well, suppose that the Hilbert space, so suppose that T has some eigenvector, okay? Take the corresponding eigenspace, and you can, that's some closed subspace of the Hilbert space, and eigenspace is obviously closed. So you can write the whole Hilbert space as that particular eigenspace direct some orthogonal complement, whatever other junk. Okay? But what we just did here, on that other junk, T is still some compact self-adjoint operator. And so now we can look in that bit and ask, does it have any eigenvectors there? If it does, we pick that eigenspace and we pull that bit out. We break up the V perp as V prime direct sum V prime perp, and we keep going until we've got until we have some leftover complementary bit that just has no eigenvectors at all. So we can always get to here. And I chose the letter Y there because Y stands for yucky. This is some yucky bit that we don't want to have to deal with. The situation we'd love to have is that operators just have eigen decompositions. In general, they don't, but what we're going to be able to prove in this setting of compact self-adjoint is actually that this Y is empty. And so that's the rest of our job, to show that Y is empty. So how do we show that Y is empty? Just show that any non-zero compact self-adjoint operator has an eigenvector. Okay? We're just going to produce an eigenvector. Now, how do we do that? We need one more lemma to get us going. The lemma is just that if T is self-adjoint, there's nothing about compact here, then you can calculate this norm in the way I told you that previously you couldn't calculate a norm. It's just the supremum over a single vector with norm 1 of the absolute value T applied to F and F over F. Remember, usually there's meant to be a separate F and a G there. Okay. And what we're going to do to show this fact here is we're going to see that if T is compact, actually this supremum is attained. It's actually a maximum, not just a supremum. And the value F at which the supremum is achieved is an eigenvector, and that's going to produce an eigenvector for us for any non-zero compact self-adjoint operator. Okay, so let's finish proving this little lemma. I think it's one of these lemmas that's boring but hard to see how to do it until someone shows you. So we're going to prove an equality by proving both inequalities. It's obvious that this guy is bigger than this. Okay, remember this is the supremum over F and G, both of norm 1, and that guy. So we're taking a supremum over a bigger set. So this is the bigger thing. So we need to prove that actually this is bigger than that. So the entirely unenlightening start to this lemma is to do the following calculation. Where did I get that from, you ask? Generations of people earlier than me knowing that this was the thing to do. So we just want to look at this and just expand everything out, because it's going to be a little bit tedious, but it won't take too long, and just see what we get. Should start the obvious place. So that's TF with F, plus TF with G, plus TG with F, plus TG with G. And now let's do the other guy. I get a minus TF with F, plus TF with G, plus TG with F, minus TG with G. Okay, so obviously a bunch of these terms conveniently cancel, and we're left with these four guys here. Those two terms are actually just the same, and these two terms are actually just the complex conjugates of those two terms. You can move the T over, because we're thinking about a self-adjoint operator, and then we can flip the inner product at the expense of the complex conjugate, and so this term is the complex conjugate of that. So we get four times the real part of TF G. Okay. Well, what is that good for? Let's see if I can fit the rest of the lemma here. that is good for is then if you look at the absolute value of this guy, 4 times the real power of TF with G. Okay, now we can look at this guy, use the triangle inequality, and use the fact we know that, well, that T is some bounded operator. So let's use Cauchy-Schwarz. And so this is bounded by the norm of T times the norm of F plus G squared plus the norm of F minus G squared. Okay, that was just applying the triangle inequality once on that minus sign, and then Cauchy-Schwarz to break up the inner product, and then using the norm of T to move the norm of T out. Okay, and then you just remember some fact from high school. So here, if we've got F and G, F plus G squared is the length of that diagonal squared, F minus G squared is the length of that diagonal squared. And you use the cosine rule a little bit and see that this is times 2 times norm of F squared plus norm of G squared.
Okay.
I mean, like, the cosine rule says that squared is that squared plus some error term involving a cosine. And similarly, you use this one, and then you see the two error terms just magically cancel because they're cosines of complementary, I've entirely forgotten my high school geometry angles. But yeah, that's just high school geometry. And we know exactly what that is. That's just, these numbers are both just one. Okay, because we're looking at vectors of norm one as we do in Supreme. Okay. So we proved that, which is all very well. What I'm going to say is now take G prime equals e to the I theta, or let's rather say G prime to be e to the I theta times G prime, with theta chosen so that TFG is real. Okay, and what do we get? We get 4 times the absolute value of TFG is bounded by 4 times the norm of T. I've done something terrible. This fact is kind of deadly obvious and completely boring. So that's not what we wanted to do. I made a mistake here. I used too strong an inequality here. So let me go back a little bit and fix that. Sorry. Okay. Let's call this quantity M. And let's go back here to doing this calculation. I'll add an extra line up here. I'll erase the stuff that's wrong. So we can fill it in correctly now. Okay. So what we actually get is that this is less than or equal to T F plus G F plus G minus T F minus G F minus G. And then that is less than M, this M here, because notice this quantity here is something of this form, although maybe the normalization is messed up. So what we can say is that that quantity is less than M times the norm of F plus G squared. And similarly, this quantity here is also something of this form. So we get another plus sign because there's only an absolute value here. So we don't know about the sign of this thing, plus another copy of M times F minus G whole squared. Okay, and so the line I really wanted to write, and we needed to put an M there, an M here, an M here, an M here, where M is this supremum, not the norm. Okay, and now I've got what I want, because I'm saying this quantity that we're taking the supremum over to get the real norm is always bounded by the right-hand side, so that thing is less than that supremum. Okay, sorry, I screwed up there and made life extra confusing. Okay. So we have this funny formula now for, not funny, it's a beautiful formula for the norm of a self-adjoint operator, and we're almost ready to prove the punchline that that compact self-regenerate operators have eigenvectors as long as they're non-zero. Okay, maybe before I erase things here, do people understand the global structure of the theorem we're proving today? We're trying to show that, that everything's got an orthonormal basis. So we use this fact to split up our Hilbert spaces, the eigenspaces, plus a yucky bit. Then we're trying to show the yucky bit is zero by showing that actually it must have another eigenvector in it, if it wasn't if it wasn't the zero vector space itself. So, if t is zero, everything is easy, okay? If t is not zero, then its norm is not zero, so the supremum is non-zero. And but the problem might be that the supremum might be zero because this quantity here inside was always negative, okay? So we want to assume, so let's assume actually that the supremum of TF with F is positive. And we can do this we can exchange T for minus T if necessary to get this, and doing that change is fine because t has an eigenvector if and only if minus t has an eigenvector. So it's okay for us to prove that either one of them has an eigenvector, and we're done. So we're allowed to assume that that supremum is positive. Okay. So in particular, there exists some f, we're about to use f, some f naught. Norm 1, so TF naught in a product F naught really is a positive number.
Yep. No, Scott, I'm just confused about the line before that, so hang on, isn't TFF a complex number?
Isn't TFF a complex number? No, TFF is actually real, so TFF equals FTF, because F is self-adjoint, equals TFF bar just by properties of the inner product, so it's real.
Yep.
Yeah, so the absolute values here are just getting in the sign for us. Nothing more. Okay, so let's try to maximize TFF, i.e., choose a sequence of Fn's unit vectors. So that TFN, FN converges to whatever the supremum is. And let's name that supremum mu to make life a little easier. Okay. So maybe actually let's defer that. I was going to prove something first, but let's see the main bit of the argument first and come back to that. Okay. So, now, TFN has a convergent subsequence. Yeah, T is compact. So let's just pass to that subsequence. Place our choice of maximizing sequence f in here with the smaller subsequence so the tfn actually converged, and say tfn converges to mu times f for some f in the Hilbert space. Okay? I mean, I'm just saying it's got some limit, and then I'm going to take whatever the limit is and divide it by mu to name my f. Okay, so we've got this point here. What we'd like to do we'd like to show actually that Fn converges to F, in which case we're done. Why is that? Well, if these Fn's actually converge to Fn, we could look at Tf. That's of course T of lim Fn. T is a bounded operator, so we can move the limit outside. And that's mu f. Okay? So if we can show that this sequence fn that we produced actually converges to f, that is, where f is the limit of tfn divided by mu, then we've actually produced an eigenvector at the end of the day. Okay? So our job is to do this. This is the remaining task, show that fn actually converges to. So, any complaints or queries about how that argument worked? Okay. So, how do we compute this? Well, we want to show convergence. So we just calculate this norm here, and we do this norm in a sort of tricky way. What do we do? First of all, let's pull out a factor of mu. And then let's get ready to do some triangle inequalitying. So we go from mu fn, and then we'll go to tfn, and then from tfn we'll go to where we're meant to be going. Triangle inequality. There, tfn minus mu. Okay, that is actually progress because that last term, I think the last term, is something we've already got control over. Yeah, we built our sequence fn so that t applied to it converged to mu fn. So this bit here is going to zero. Okay, so our remaining job is to show that this goes to zero. The way I'm writing it on the board is actually in a slightly different order than what's in the notes. The notes does a lot of setting things up ahead of time and then using them. Like, we first of all go and prove that this goes to zero before we even start thinking about this or this convergent subsequence and so on. Hopefully doing it this way around is a little bit more helpful. I mean, hopefully you can see that most of the steps here are kind of the obvious things to be doing. Okay, so we want to compute that, it's actually not so bad. We look at t minus mu fn, the norm of that all squared, and then just expand out the norm using the inner product. So this is, of course, just t minus mu fn, t minus mu fn, which we this. So here, to collect the two cross terms here, I used the same fact here, about self-adjointness, to use the fact that, see that the product was actually real, and then plus mu squared, fn squared. But that if n squared is 1, we chose our vectors to be norm 1. Then whatever this quantity is, it's less than the norm of t squared. Okay, but the norm of t squared, remember, we proved the norm of t squared was this quantity here. So this is actually mu squared here. And then factorize. Sorry, is it 2? So 2 comes out the front as well. Did that. And by assumption, we set up our fn's so that tfn, inappropriate fn, was converging to mu. So that whole thing is going to 0. Okay? I think that does it. Just on time to be at the end of the proof, not quite where I thought we'd get up to as usual. We should definitely... yeah, so on Friday, the two things we will do are point out some counterexamples to this theorem. If you drop self-adjoint, it all goes horribly wrong. This is really about self-adjoint operators. We'll prove a nice application of it. And maybe we won't really have time to talk about this, so let me just say this as you're packing up and leaving. Notice that this proof was sort of horribly non-constructive. And I want you to maybe think about this. There's something interesting going on here. When you diagonalize a finite dimensional operator, a matrix, you know what to do. Like there's an algorithm that extracts the eigenvectors. Okay? You calculate a determinant, you factorize it, you then go calculate a null space. But here, if we actually wanted to take some compact self-adjoint operator and produce the orthonormal basis, it's a little bit unclear what would happen. And the step at which it's a little bit unclear what would happen is when we do this. Okay? If you just know that these quantities here are bounded above, and this quantity is sometimes positive, it's not really clear how you constructively choose this sequence of elements. Okay, it's not actually clear how you extract from this argument an actual algorithm to really diagonalize a compact self-adjoint operator. There are good ways to do this, and there is, in some sense, a better proof that actually shows you how to produce this eigenvector. The rough idea is, well, let me not write it, but imagine you're in the really nice situation that the eigenspace corresponding to the norm, to this supremum, was just one-dimensional. How could you find an eigenvector in there? Well, you could just take an arbitrary vector and keep hitting it with t and normalizing it again so it's norm 1 again after every step. Okay? And what's going to happen is you think of that vector as being a big sum of vectors in all the different eigenspaces. As you repeatedly hit it with t and then normalize it again, the components in all the other eigenspaces shrink down to nothing, and you're left with the component that's just in the principal eigenspace. Okay, and that would give you a constructive way of producing an eigenvector in that top eigenspace. It's a little more subtle if this top eigenspace is more than one-dimensional, or if the supremum is mu, but negative mu is also an eigenvector, an eigenvalue, then it's even harder again to pick out an eigenvector. But there are ways all around all of those. It's just worth being aware that this is a sort of non-constructed soft analysis argument you gave here, and there's a better version of it that produces the eigenvector.